Good morning. So I get a lot of questions online about the film cameras I'm using and film camera suggestions. So today I gathered a collection of my cameras and I'm going to talk a little bit about each one. I've got 35 millimeter, I've got medium format, and even my large format camera here. So without further ado, we'll start with the 35 millimeter. This guy here, a Rollei 35. This is the SE model, but there's a few other models. It's a great little compact camera. Full manual control, so you've got aperture control on the right and shutter speed control on the left. The lens here, to make it even smaller, it's retractable, so when you're ready to shoot, just pop it out and lock it in place, and you're good to go. Kind of a quirky little camera, can be a bit tricky to use, but yeah, some of the things here, like for example, when you load the film, you load it inverted into the camera, you load it upside down. So it doesn't really matter, but your edge codes are all going to be upside down. Film rewind levers on the bottom. It's kind of neat. Hot shoes on the bottom. It does have a built-in meter, this model and most of the other models, I believe, but can be a bit tricky to get the battery for them. Probably the hardest thing about using this camera, though, is there's no visual way to verify the focus. You actually have to use scale focus. So that means just setting the proper distance on your scale. Now, for landscape shots, it's going to be really easy. Just set it to infinity and take your shot. But for a portrait, like you kind of have to guesstimate the distance. So maybe someone's 2 meters away, maybe they're 2.5, and you try to tune that in on the scale here, which can be pretty hard. You'll lose a few shots when you first start using it, but gets a lot easier with practice. So great little camera, take it anywhere with you, and great quality. The lens is an f/2.8. It's a 40 millimeter high quality lens and leaf shutter. So yeah, once you master this guy, it's a great little camera. Moving on up, we've got an old Soviet camera here. This is a Zorki 4. The Soviets produced a whole line of Zorkis and Fed cameras. Fairly similar. They're kind of like Leica ripoffs. They feel nice and solid. They're great little range finders. Yeah, range finder control works pretty well. Yeah, manual controls. You got your aperture, you got your shutter speed. No meter on this one, so you'll have to, get your own light meter or use a light meter app on your phone. But yeah, it works pretty well. Nice durable camera. The quality can be a bit iffy. This one sometimes has trouble cocking the shutter. But no, it's been working pretty well. Pretty cheap camera too. They must have produced like thousands and thousands of these. So this one I got when traveling the Czech Republic. It cost maybe $30 US equivalent. So yeah, kind of a cool camera if you're just looking to start out. I'll set that aside. Personally, my first camera, this one here, probably one of my favorite cameras still. It's the Nikon FM2. So many nice things about this. I mean, it's a Nikon camera, so you've got great selection of lenses. Works with pretty much every Nikon lens except their newest gelded models. Yeah, really sweet. It's got a nice action to it. It's all mechanical, so even if the battery for the meter runs out, all the shutter speeds still work. The small battery in here that runs the meter actually lights it up on the inside, so even in low light situations, you can tell if you're getting a properly metered situation. Yeah, just really nice camera. Never failed me. Still really affordable. The FM2, even the FE and the FE2 are great, but FM2 is kind of a cult favorite. Yeah, not much else I can say. Just a rock solid camera. Definitely my recommendation if you can find one. If you're looking for something more modern, this one's kind of cool. This is the Nikon F4s. It was Nikon's flagship model, probably in the 80s sometime. So it was their top of the line camera. It's it's got this battery pack on the bottom. You can find it without that, but yeah, it takes about six batteries to run with this thing. But just a huge feature set. I mean, it reads DX coding, has a high frame rate. I think it's like 5.7 frames a second, like something crazy to shoot film that fast. I don't know why you would, but yeah, what else? We've got like different meterings modes, matrix metering, spot metering, all set on the top here. Yeah, what do we got? Like aperture priority, shutter speed priority, program, manual. We got exposure compensation, just a huge feature set. I mean, I don't even know all the things this can do. Different autofocusing modes, so it'll work with the autofocusing lenses. Yeah, this will work. I think it's been called the holy grail of, you know, Nikon compatibility, because this camera will work with like every Nikon lens, even the newest ones. And yeah, works sweet. I've even put DX lenses on this, and it's pretty cool. The 35mm 1.8 DX works great on this. It gives you a bit of a vignette, but a really cool kind of image. So yeah, if you've, you know, these things, good value too. I think maybe when they came out, might have been a few thousand dollars, but I think I picked this up for about 400 a couple of years ago. So yeah, it's just a really professional camera, and great to use. Medium format. So yeah, let's start with the Hasselblad. When people say medium format, you know, a lot of the times that's the go-to, you know, Hasselblad. It's an iconic name. I mean, these ones here, the 500 series, they went to the moon back in the day. Not this exact model, they had modified ones with big handles and stuff, but more or less the same. What can I say about this? So the coolest thing about Hasselblad is probably that it's a fully modular setup, and just a really high quality setup too. Naturally, you can attach different lenses. You've got detachable film backs. You have different viewing options here too. Even the focusing screen you can take out, but I'm not going to. And what you're left with is this nice quality Hasselblad box here that works great. So yeah, what can I say? Let's see. Yeah, it's a square format camera, and the negatives are about four times bigger than your 35mm film, so the quality is going to be huge, not to mention coupled with quality lenses, you know, it's going to be a sweet setup. For example, there's also, like, on the top, there's a prism finder you can put on, so if you don't like the waist level looking down at the image and you don't like it inverted left to right, you can always find a prism finder, pop that on there. These things are a bit pricey, but they hold their value really well, so you know, it's a fairly good investment. Here, let me pop these back on here. As for the film backs, if you're not familiar with interchangeable film backs, it's one of the handiest features of the Hasselblad system, in that what you have here, the back, is actually a film magazine. It holds the film, and basically it's protected behind this silver slide here called the dark slide. When it's attached to the camera, you can remove the dark slide and you're ready to expose the film and make images. But let's say you're maybe halfway through a black and white roll and there's a beautiful sunset and you want to capture that on color. Well, the beauty of the system is you can detach the film mid-roll, keep it safe and protected inside the closed container, and then you can attach another film back, which is possibly color or slide or whatever you like. Hell, you could have color and you could have slide, and attach whichever one you want, remove the dark slide, and make the image. So, you know, you don't have to be as choosy about what you're gonna load or trying to get rid of, you know, a roll of film so you can load something else. I mean, it just makes it way easier. So a few other features on this guy that are kind of nice. It's got mirror lockup, and you can change the winder, and the lens is a leaf shutter lens. So if you use flash, you can do a few, you know, nice things with that. All shutter speeds work. But yeah, real beauty of a camera. Definitely a bit pricier, but if you can go for it, it will hold its value pretty well. So I'll put that back. Oops, sure. Next up, this guy's great. Iconic and... what can I say about this one? It's... what's the word I'm looking for? I don't know, a beast is what it is. It's definitely got a huge following. It's a huge camera, Pentax 6.7. So the Hasselblad takes 6cm by 6cm negatives. The Pentax 6.7 takes 6x7, so you're getting a rectangular image. It's more like a 4x5 aspect ratio, to be honest, if you kind of look at it. But yeah, even bigger negatives. Therefore, you get less shots per roll. Something like the Hasselblad or the Mamiya will give you 12 shots, whereas the 6.7 will give you 10 shots on a roll of 120. So, you know, bigger negative, kind of higher stakes, depending on what you're looking for, it's a cool option. So there's a bunch of different, the system isn't as modular, but you can get different viewing accessories. There's a waist level one, and there's also unmetered prisms, but this is one of my go-tos just because it has a metered prism. If I'm not looking to, you know, take a light meter with me and take my time, if I'm in a bit more of a rush, I can go with this one, and it's got a nice like needle match sort of meter. Lens is great. This is what usually comes with them. This is the 105 2.4. So to have such a big negative and an f2.4 lens is really nice. What else? The action on it is pretty loud. It's some people say it can cause a bit of shutter shake if you're not careful, but I haven't had too much trouble with that. I mean, just listen to this thing. There's not film in there. I hope not. Yeah, no. You can trick it into firing by doing a few things. Let's see here. Actually, let's look at that. Set this bad boy to bulb. Yeah, just to give you an idea. All right, yeah, Pentax 6.7. These guys are pretty good value. They made a few different models. This is the 6.7, which I personally really like. It's a good price point. If you go to the 6.7 II, it gets a lot pricier, and you know, you've got a few more issues there with like battery usage and such. There's also older models. There's the 6x7, 6x7, as opposed to just the 6.7. And it lacks a few features like mirror lockup, though it's been added to some of them. And mirror lockup can be really handy if you're looking to, if you're worried about that shutter shake or the mirror slap shake in the camera, because you can just like lock it up and then take the exposure, and it's a bit more stable. Yeah, but definitely a good camera. Good value too, and with all these cameras, you know, they're going to be a bit pricier if you find a good one, but they'll maintain their value. So, okay, what we have here, my Mamiya C330. So it's a TLR, and TLRs are kind of totally different ball game than these other two, which are SLRs. SLRs are a single lens reflex. They have one lens. They have a mirror that, you know, you look through the lens, mirror slaps up, and shutter opens and exposes the film. TLRs are quite different because you have a viewing lens and a taking lens. Pop that up, and you're going to view through the viewfinder. There are prism attachments to the C330 system. It's quite modular, but in this case, it's a waist level viewfinder, so you're looking down through the viewfinder. You're looking at the image that's coming into the into the viewing lens, and then the taking lens is just below it. That's got all your settings like aperture and shutter speed, and because they're close together, there's not too much of a problem. They're pretty much going to see the same thing, or at least at reasonable distances. If you take a picture of something really close up, you have to compensate for the parallax. But it's a really smart system, super quiet too, just because the mirror in here reflects what's in the viewing lens. There's no mirror or anything down here. The lens is always closed until you make the exposure. Simply opens and exposes the film that's at the back. Hopefully that makes sense. A few nice things about this: dual shutter releases, so you got the one at the bottom. You got this thumb one on the side. Great for macro work too. It's got a bit of a bellows there that extends. So as opposed to other TLRs, you can focus a lot closer. That being said, the closer you focus, the more you're likely to get that kind of parallax error where the two lenses are seeing separate things. Though there is a nice little, probably can't see it here, but there's a a line that moves down to give you an idea of where the top of your frame is as you focus super close. Nice feature, helps out a ton. Mamiya C330, definitely a cool camera and also a modular system. So unlike other TLRs, you can switch the lenses, a lot of different viewing accessories. I think there's like a pistol grip for it, a few other things. This guy can do multiple exposures, can shoot 120 or 220. Same with the Pentax, 120 or 220. Hasselblad requires a different back for 220. What else? Yeah, nice camera. A few different models. This one's the original. It's great, but there's also, I think, a professional S and a professional F. And if you can find those, pretty good value too. All right, so that's medium format. You know, three different kind of cameras, styles, if you will. All right, last but not least, we have large format. So the large format camera I have is a Zone 6 field camera. For the most part, all large format cameras work the same way, whether they're 4x5 like this one or even bigger like 8x10. You shoot sheets individually that are loaded into these film magazines, sometimes called double dark slides, because they have two sides for two sheets of film. Totally different than shooting something like canister film, like 35mm, or roll film like 120. Definitely takes a longer amount of time to set up, compose your shot, and shoot. But if you pull it off, you've got huge, huge negatives, and it's well worth it. So, nice thing about large format is no matter which camera you get, whether it's a Zone 6 or whether it's like a Wista, Toyo, Linhav, you're pretty much going to be able to use the same lenses, because the lenses, take a look here. This is like a Nikkor W series. I also have a Fujinon, but basically you got your lens and your shutter, and you just mount them to lens boards that will fit your camera. So no compatibility issues there. The optics and the shutter is really what's going to determine how your image looks. The optics and shutter is really going to determine how your image looks, because at the end of the day, the camera itself doesn't have a lot of mechanics. In fact, it has no mechanics. The lens itself is where you're going to find the shutter. Shutter release. The camera itself serves as a place to mount your lens and mount your film back, or mount your double dark slot, and keep it dark in between them. Differences in cameras are going to do a few things for you. They'll give you a certain amount of extension, so depending on your lens or if you're looking to focus really close to something, that's going to make a difference. Also movements. Each camera will have like different amounts of movement. So movements involve turning or twisting the focal plane, like here. So that'll do things like, adjust your focal plane. You can, instead of like a flat invisible wall moving back and forth, you can twist it. You can also use movements for perspective correction. So straight lines will stay straight rather than swept back. A few other things that are nice about this camera: the bail back. There's different backs for cameras. It's just a way to put your double dark slide in, but this one's pretty handy and works really well. No parts come off of it, so it stays relatively intact. Also, a really nice thing about this guy here is that going from landscape portrait orientation is really easy. You don't have to turn the camera, you can just remove the back itself and reattach it in the vertical orientation. There you go. But that's pretty much it. As a field camera, this one's kind of nice. It's relatively compact, it actually folds up. Rail mounted large formats cameras aren't really the same. So yeah, at the end of the day, deciding on a large format camera, you're going to look at, you know, price, looks, and movements and features, but you know, in the end of the day, the lenses are what's really making the difference. It's just nice to have a nice sort of camera like this. Yeah, fold that up. There we go. So just like a nice little briefcase there. Take it with you. You also might need a loop for focusing on the back. It's like a magnifier. And a dark cloth just for covering up the back so you don't get any reflections of light. But yeah, that's my camera collection there. Thanks very much for watching. If you have any questions, let me know. Thanks. Have a good one.